This week in Virology, the podcast about viruses, the kind that make you sick.
From Microbe TV, this is TWiV, This Week in Virology. This is episode 407, recorded on September 13th, 2016. This episode is brought to you by CuriosityStream, a subscription streaming service that offers over 1,500 documentaries and nonfiction series from the world's best filmmakers. Get unlimited access starting at just $2.99 a month. And for our audience, the first 2 months are completely free if you sign up at curiositystream.com/microbe and use the promo code microbe. This episode is also sponsored by Drobo, a family of safe, expandable, yet simple to use storage arrays. Drobos are designed to protect your important data forever. Visit drobo.com to learn more. Hi, everybody. I'm Vincent Racaniello, and you're listening to the podcast all about viruses. I'm coming to you today from Chapel Hill, North Carolina. I'm at the Department of Microbiology and Immunology, and we're doing the largest TWiV ever. We have to split it into two. This is part one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 faculty, virology faculty. Then we're going to do another one with six more. Is that the plan? Six more. And all of this is because of Blossom Demania, who's sitting here in the audience. Of course, Blossom was on TWiV 359, and so that's why she's not here again. But she suggested that because we have so much virology here in the department, that what's the maximum number that you could do on a podcast? And this is the maximum number. I actually could do one more, but I'm not, because it's too much. I don't have any more mics, actually. I do have an opening here for one more. So this is the maximum, and we're going to talk with these faculty members about their work. Of course, we can't do extended conversations. We'd be here forever and ever. But we'll learn what they do. We'll highlight the department and the cool science that goes on here, and then we'll do it again in an hour or so, an hour and a half. So other members of this department who've been on TWiV include Blossom, as I said, on 359. Stan Lemon, he's not here today. He was on TWiV 389. Helen Lazier was on a TWiV, and she'll actually be in part two of what Blossom likes to call the twin TWiVs. Right? That's a good name. But anyway, keep in mind the name for this episode. You can do that while we're recording. If somebody says something clever, and it could be a title, think of it, and I'll ask you at the end. All right, so my guests, I put them, I think, in alphabetical order, because some of them I've just met for the first time today. On my left, I met yesterday, they're all professors in microbiology and immunology, so I don't need to go through each of their titles. On my left, Dirk Dittmer. Welcome to TWiV.
Hello. Good to be here.
That's right. That's what we like to hear.
We'll start.
Could you lower the house levels a bit? Just a tad so we don't get any ringing. Because my recorder is doing great. And in the end, that's what matters because we'll release the recording. Also, next to Dirk, another professor in the department, Carrie Moody. Welcome to TWiV.
Oh, thank you. It's great to be here.
You're welcome. Pleasure. Next to Carrie, Nat Moorman. Welcome.
Good to be here. Thank you.
So Dirk, I met yesterday for the first time. Carrie and Nat, I have not even introduced myself to. Nice to meet both of you.
Nice to meet you as well.
We have not met before, right?
No.
Next to Nat is someone I've known for many, many years. In fact,
let's not go there.
I was here 20 years ago to give a seminar, and she's one of the few people who were here at the time, Nancy Robb Traub. Welcome to TWiV.
Nice to be here.
Thank you. And I've met you many times. Also, now next to Nancy, someone else I have not met, or maybe many years ago, I met you, Lishan Su. Welcome to TWiV.
Hello. I met you probably 25 years ago when you first talked about your polio transgenic mice model.
Really? A seminar?
Seminar.
Wow. Cool. That's great. I'm glad to see that you made it through the ranks and now you have your own lab.
I didn't quit virology.
Thank you. And finally, again, someone I haven't met all the way at the end there, Jennifer Webster Syriac.
Thanks for having me.
Is that the right way to pronounce your
Absolutely.
Name?
Absolutely. One of the very few people.
Syriac. It's a wonderful name. How do most people mangle it?
Creq.
Mine is, as you may guess, gets mangled up all the time. So you know how I tell people to, how to remember to pronounce my name? Black and Yellow. The younger of you in the audience will know that that's a rap song, right? Yes? The older will have no clue, like me, when I was first told. Black and Yellow. Syriac. Okay, I'm going to ask each of you a series of questions. Maybe I'll go down and do the first round and then come back, and we'll see however I feel. The first one I want to know is where you are from and where you were educated, college, grad school, postdoc, and all that. We'll start with you. I guess you're from Germany, right?
I am from Germany.
Where?
I grew up in West Berlin when it was still wow. West Berlin, so I could actually hear the dogs bark from my bedroom window. And I studied biochemistry there, and then moved on to graduate studies to Princeton. That was about 1989, so I was, that's incidentally when the wall came down, so it was the biggest party on the earth, and I was in New Jersey. So it tells you that I like science and virology a lot. I stayed at Princeton for my graduate studies with Arne Levine working on P53. And mostly P53. And then I moved on to Stanford to work on cytomegalovirus with Ed Mokarski. And at that time, I was in the middle of the postdoc, and KSHV, Kaposi sarcoma associated herpes virus, was discovered. It was discovered by Moore and Chang, and people started working on it up the road at UC San Francisco, so I switched labs and moved to Don Gannon's lab for a second postdoc. Got my first position at the University of Oklahoma Health Sciences Center, and then through some personal connection ended up here at UNC Chapel Hill, where I've been for the last 10 years.
Great, Princeton. So you must have known Lynn Enquist and Tom Schenck, Jane Flint.
Yeah, they taught me virology. Yeah. That's from the book that they wrote
the book,
with
yeah?
you. Yes.
I want to fix your mic because it's rubbing against your shirt here and we don't want to have scratching noises. There we go. So you used our textbook while you were there, right?
I used the textbook before it was a textbook.
Yeah, it was experimental, right?
Yeah.
All right. So do you go back to Germany? You must have family there, right?
Yeah, my parents are there, so we go back once a year.
Yeah, it's changed, right?
It changed quite a bit, yes.
Yeah, I'm sure. Okay, Carrie, tell us your history. Where are you from?
I'm from Mississippi.
Wow.
Originally.
Yeah. I just visited Mississippi State.
Oh, that's where I did my undergrad.
Who's the older guy who was like the celebrated microbiologist? Brown, maybe?
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Does he work on a bacteriologist?
Yeah, a bacterium.
Yeah.
It was a lecture series in his honor.
Oh.
And I went, and they gave me as a prize a cowbell.
Oh, yes.
With a plaque on it, you know, the lecture plaque. And so I bring this all the time on TWiV. So you went to undergrad there. You grew up there. You went to high school and undergrad.
Yep, I went to high school in Columbus, Mississippi, and then went to Mississippi State, which is about 30 minutes away from my hometown.
Okay.
And then I went to LSU Health Sciences Center, the medical school there in Shreveport, Louisiana, for my PhD, where I worked on Epstein-Barr virus in John Sixby's lab.
Okay.
And then from there, I moved north to Chicago and went to Northwestern University Medical School for a postdoc in Lou Lehman's lab, where I started working on human papillomavirus.
Right.
And was there for about 5.5 years, and then came down here to start as an assistant professor about 6 years ago.
So you're relatively new?
Yes. Right.
And this is your first job?
Yes.
Here as well. Okay, wonderful. Nat, tell us where you're from.
So I'm from Springfield, Illinois, and then went to get my undergraduate degree in microbiology at the University of Illinois before I headed down to St. Louis to work for a few years as a technician for David Lieb, who studies herpes simplex virus, and then stayed at WashU for grad school to work with Sam Speck and Skip Virgin as my co-mentors. And then after that, a little time in the gamma herpes viruses, I went to Princeton for my postdoc with Tom Schenck, where I started working on human cytomegalovirus, which is what I still work on here. And so let's see, I've been here, well, exactly as many days as you've been here, Carrie. We started on the same day.
So far we have only DNA virologists. What's the story? Is that going to be the entire panel? I think so, right?
Yes, for this first session. You?
Oh, you do a little RNA virus, okay. And the second we have.
Second is all RNA.
I think we should. It's a bad thing.
No, I like to joke because obviously I'm an RNA virologist, and I think they're fabulous and the best things in the world. And I have to tell you, I was on study section with Blossom, right? I was always surrounded by herpes virologists. There were always so many of them.
They're dead now.
That's right. That's why there were. I have this sort of feeling about them because there were so many of them on study sections. Why should the biggest viruses always get all the money? Right. Anyway, moving on. Nancy Rob Traub, where are you from?
I'm from Chicago. Uh-huh. And I went to undergraduate at the University of Michigan, where I had a wonderful opportunity to work as a technician in a laboratory that was studying multiple viruses, including Sendai and SV40. And I participated in isolating measles virus from a brain biopsy as an undergraduate. So. From subacute sclerosing panencephalitis. Mm. So that kind of hooked me on virology.
What lab was that?
That was Francis Payne mm-hmm. at Michigan. And then I loved being a technician, so I went to San Francisco and worked in a lab that was just starting prenatal diagnosis back in the very early days, 69. And then I moved back to Chicago and I stayed as a technician for another 5 years. And then I started graduate school with Dr. Elliot Keefe at the University of Chicago, when Chicago was the center of the herpes world. Mm-hmm. And so I...
Not anymore.
There is no herpes, but...
it's here.
It's here now. It's here. The center of the herpes world is here. So I had Pat Spear and Bernard Roisman and Elliot and Nisa Frankel and all the original herpes virologists. And I was very interested in EBV's ability to cause cancer. And one of the famous cancers that it was linked to was nasopharyngeal carcinoma, work that Joe Pagano had started here. So I decided I would come here to be a postdoc with Joe and start trying to do some of the molecular biology I had learned in Elliott's lab. And like everyone who comes to North Carolina, I didn't want to leave. So I was able to stay. And I always say that I have intellectual herpes because I have never been able to stop working on herpes viruses, and I have still have Epstein-Barr virus dreams.
Wonderful. So I interviewed Joe Pagano before this for a little independent TWiV, so look for that in the coming weeks. It was a lot of fun. Li Shan, where are you from?
I'm from China. Qingdao is the city I grew up. Mm-hmm. Best known for its beer.
Beer, I was going to say, yeah.
Qingdao beer. So I came here to Boston for graduate school.
Right.
Start. I just tell Nancy I can quit herpes sometimes. So I start a PhD working on herpes simplex virus, gene regulation with David Knipe.
Knipe, right.
Debating about DNA virus and RNA virus with Bernie Fields' lab all the time. After that, I moved to Stanford. Joined Irwin Weissman's lab to learn immunology and stem cell biology. So after many years of that, I work in a company Weissman started called the Systemics, where we study human stem cell biology and stem cell-based gene therapy for HIV. So after we failed that gene therapy, I decided to come back to mm-hmm. the academic to learn more about immunology and virology. So I came here 20 years ago exactly, and starting to use HIV to study immunology, the immune system.
So I met you when you were a student in David Knipe's lab, is that correct?
Yeah.
Wow. So it seems here that nobody leaves, right? People like it here. Only the students and postdocs leave, I guess. All right, Jennifer, where are you from?
I'm from Long Island, New York.
You're kidding.
I'm not kidding. West Babylon.
Wow.
Yeah.
Cool.
So I grew up there and then went to SUNY Buffalo for college and stayed there for dental school. Uh-huh. And then while I was in dental school, there are so many diseases, so many mucosal diseases that we don't know how they develop. So I decided to do the dental scientist program, and North Carolina was one of few of those programs in the country. They had a strong oral medicine program, which mm-hmm. I did over at the hospital, and then I did my PhD with Nancy in the cancer center. On Epstein-Barr virus. Mm-hmm. We had a huge AIDS cohort at that time, and I studied the hairy leukoplakia lesion in her laboratory. And then I stayed on and did a postdoc and then joined the faculty in 2000.
Wonderful. Did you find Buffalo a little chilly?
Absolutely.
A lot of snow up there. This is nicer, right?
It was not difficult for me to get used to this.
Is everybody okay with the levels? Can you hear? Yes? a little higher on any particular people? Lishan?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. He's number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. That's this one here. So Lishan, it must have been pretty cool to have Bernie Fields. Who else? Jim Hogel was in that department, right?
For virology, yeah. This is Bernie Field, David Knipe, and Priscilla Schaeffer. Don Cohen. All the herpes
right?
virologists.
Yeah. Is that better?
Is okay. it better?
Yeah. Anybody else? Priscilla's okay? Oh, next time you tell me, okay, raise your hand. All right, next question. Well, let me fix your mic. I'm sorry. It's kind of bendy, and it gets noisy when it's bendy, you know. We don't want to have bad noise. Okay. Who told you to wear this shirt anyway?
I got very good
Blossom.
Advice.
Yeah.
How did you get interested in science?
How did I get it? Well, I had a very good high school teacher who actually took us to the university and exposed us to the cool stuff that was going on. And there's a lot going on in the big city. And also back in the late 1980s, I was listening to you earlier and I wondered why would I get into science. Growing up in Berlin was kind of interesting because it was the beginning of the HIV epidemic. And I remembered on the few occasions that I went to bars in the city, you would always see two things shortly after HIV was discovered. The one thing you would see was this big jar of condoms, which was, of course, the public health message. And the other thing that you would see is a little red book by some, which we now think is an agent of the East, that said that HIV was created at Fort Detrick, Maryland, wipe out the human race. And that didn't make sense because I understood even back then enough biology that that was far-fetched. But it started me, and then I went up to Princeton to really see what science was about and to start working on viruses and cancer, which I've been working on ever since.
Okay. How about you, Carrie? What got you interested?
Well, like Dirk, I had a really good high school science teacher, but then also an undergrad, I was taking a bacterial pathogenesis class, and I just thought it was really cool, and I thought I was going to be a bacteriologist, but then I decided to get a master's first because I hadn't had any research experience at all, and the only person that had an opening was someone that worked on bovine immunodeficiency virus at Mississippi State. So I decided to do a master's and I just fell in love with virology and science and then decided to do a PhD looking at viruses that cause cancer.
By the way, it was Lewis Brown. That's the name of the professor. So he was famous at Mississippi State because he was the first person to get a big NIH grant, I think, or any NIH grant at the time. And then in those years, there were only three people apparently in the whole state that had NIH grants, and he was instrumental in getting more money, so everyone appreciated him. Lewis Brown, is it?
Yeah, yeah. I had a friend that was a technician in his lab during undergrad, and so I'd go down there all the time, and he was really, really nice.
Nat, what got you interested in science?
I've been trying to think of that while you two answered that. I really have no idea. I don't come from any kind of science or academic background. My parents are social workers. Basically, sometime in high school, I think I just got it in my head that I wanted to be a virologist, strangely enough.
In high school?
And I, as an undergrad, I was admitted into the microbiology program and was furious that there was almost no virology at the University of Illinois at the time. And that was it, and just stuck with it.
It's interesting, most people have a teacher or something, but that works too, if it just popped into your head.
I have no idea.
So you didn't read a book or anything like that?
No, there's no hot zone backstory.
Fever.
Nope.
Yeah, all right.
No traumatic incident.
Nancy, how about you?
I also had an excellent teacher, and my excellent science teacher, my first one, was in eighth grade. And so that really got me interested in science, and which I continued in high school. But what I particularly remember was going to the Seattle World's Fair and seeing a picture and a poster of a bacteriophage. Mm. And I was transfixed that these molecules could interact and shoot their DNA into the cells. And that was my first interest in virology, which then continued as an undergraduate. But what I particularly loved was actually doing the lab work, and I'm sure my lab would really laugh at that now. and I actually love to do tissue culture. I love to do tissue culture, grow viruses, purify them, and I thought I would stay working in a lab forever. But we know that those things change.
So the pictures are so powerful. I work a lot with ASM in communicating, and they like to just put big pictures in public places like train stations and museum of bacteria and viruses, and people really respond to that because, wow, first of all, you make a big print and it's really impressive, but they just look cool. And nowadays you can colorize them and make them really interesting. So the main important things, science teachers and pictures, getting people into science. What about you, Lishan?
I grew up in a family with no science background, and all my family are history or humanity. I was fully trained to be have an academic career in probably literature or history until my high school physics teacher convinced me microbiology is the future of anything, everything, where you need both science and humanity and history. So he convinced me. I have no idea what was microbiology when I applied. Yeah, so that's how I got into it.
Okay. Jennifer.
I had a really great microbiology experience while I was in dental school, but the biggest driver for me was those diseases that we see in the patients that we didn't have an answer for, and those malignancies. So that's really what stimulated my interest in DNA tumor viruses.
Nice.
This episode is brought to you by CuriosityStream, the world's first ad-free nonfiction streaming service with over 1,500 titles and 600 hours of content. It was founded by John Hendricks of Discovery Channel, so you know you're going to get access to real science shows, not the reality TV shows that are currently plaguing cable TV. CuriosityStream can be viewed on many different platforms, the web, a number of devices like Roku, Android, iOS, Chromecast, Amazon Fire, Kindle, and Apple TV. It's available in 196 countries all over the world. And what they have, which may be of interest to our listeners, is a wide variety of science and technology content. They also have nature, history, and many other topics. For example, they also have interviews and lectures. Their library includes a series by Stephen Hawking called Stephen Hawking's Universe. Here, Stephen Hawking traces the history of astronomical theories and technology. If you know Stephen Hawking, you're going to love that. They also have Deep Time History. This is a three-part original documentary series telling the story of the universe's 14 billion-year history. And it has some surprising twists to stories you thought you knew. They also have Underwater Wonders of the National Parks. This is the 100th year celebration of the U.S. National Park Service. In celebration, they have a 7-part series that takes you on a journey below the bodies of water that are in these national parks. Enrich your life and continue learning with one of the largest nonfiction 4K libraries on the internet. They have over 50 hours of ultra high definition content. Pretty cool stuff. You want to see this? They have monthly and annual plans available. They start at $2.99 a month. Less than a cup of coffee, even a bottle of water, or of course, at least one title on one of their competing on-demand platforms. So check out CuriosityStream.com/microbe and use the promo code microbe during sign up to get unlimited access to the world's top documentaries and nonfiction series completely free for the first 60 days. That's 2 entire months free of one of the largest nonfiction 4K libraries around. Just go to CuriosityStream.com/microbe and use the offer code microbe at sign up. We thank CuriosityStream for their support of TWiV.
Okay, so now you see how everyone got into science. Let's talk a little bit about science. When you came here to UNC, so this was your second faculty position. What were you working on at the time?
Kaposi sarcoma associated herpes virus, which is a a cancer that a virus that causes cancers in immune deficient people.
Mm-hmm. And what were you doing? What aspects of KSHV?
Well, back then, anything, because it was a brand new virus. Mm-hmm. So we wanted to see how did it work. Could we build an animal model, which we're getting better at, but we're nowhere near. And once you know the virus, how can we kill it? That's sort of what we do in my lab. We meet new viruses and then we kill them.
How can you kill it? It's not living.
How do you eradicate the disease?
You would like to do something like that, but when do you get Kaposi's? What point in life?
Well, so that's really interesting because you get many forms. You get it as an old person. Mm-hmm. You can get it as a very young child when you are in Africa. And it's like one of the Epstein-Barr virus tumors, like Burkitt's lymphomas. And then in the US, people first notice it as the signature malignancy of HIV infection. And people, again, that their immune system was compromised by HIV. And the first time I saw it on a patient was in Miami, where this 80-year-old little lady was going around with a lesion on her foot because she had a kidney transplant. So those are the four cases. You are immune deficient as a child, you're immune deprived as a very old person, and then you have traumatic experiences that all weaken your immune system, and of course that's when the herpes viruses come out. So the statistics that blew me away is that your chance of becoming immune suppressed as a normal person is 1 in 6. Not because of, maybe because of HIV, maybe because of chemotherapy, maybe because you're fighting another virus. And that's when all those things come out, and we're trying to understand those.
So is it a goal to have a vaccine or an antiviral? Would that be better?
Either one. I think a vaccine is far away, but quite possible. An anti-tumor in this case is what we're actively working for and where we moved some of the compounds into clinical trials.
Mm-hmm. All right, so if you fast forward to today, how many years ago did you come here again? 15?
10 years.
Ten years ago. So now, how is the work similar? The same ideas, KSHV, same goals, or has anything changed?
Two things has changed. One is we're really using next generation sequencing a lot. Mm-hmm. So we generate a lot more data, and that created some problems because you have to understand more data.
Right.
And then my lab, at least part of it, has moved very much into translational research. We still do a lot of basic research because that's where the ideas come from, but at the same time, we're moving more and more into patients to understand what the virus does in the human host, and that's been very rewarding.
So looking forward, are you going to be doing the same things for the next 10 years? Do you think something will change dramatically?
Well, we just started growing Zika, like everyone else. So I might, maybe maybe for a couple of weeks, I work on an RNA virus.
Right.
They're just so small, it's not quite what I'm after.
Okay, there's no RNA virus in your future, but Zika is appealing. Why are you growing it? What do you want to do?
Well, again, it's just fascinating to look at a new virus. Like, there's this scene in Outbreak where the Dustin Hoffman character for the first time looks at the Ebola virus under the microscopes, and that's just really cool. And so I had that when I was in Stanford. There was KSHV, and you could see the herpes virus. When I was in Oklahoma, 1999 was when West Nile virus came to the US, and we had the only BSL-3 lab in the state. Mm-hmm. And here's Zika, and it's just plain old cool.
So in the outbreak, was he looking at it under a light microscope?
Probably.
No, I don't know. I think there are like 22 factual errors in the movie in the first 10 minutes. You've probably seen it too.
Yeah, it's one of the worst ones. So you're driven a lot by new things, KSHV, Zika, whatever the future. If a brand new herpes virus of humans were discovered,
we'll move on to it.
You'd move on to it as well? All right. Carrie, now you've only been here 6 years. Mm-hmm. So I like to get a perspective of how someone's work was and now, but probably you're still on the same trajectory. So what are you working on? Tell us about it.
So my lab works on the life cycle of human papillomaviruses. Mm-hmm. We mainly focus on the high-risk types, which are associated with the human cancers, most notably cervical cancer, where HPV causes 99% of cervical mm-hmm. cancers, but also is associated with an increasing number of a certain type of head and neck cancer.
Right.
In cancers, the virus is often found to be integrated, and that is a dead end for the virus because it can't make any new virus, and mm-hmm. so we're interested in studying the virus when it's still episomal, or a circle, and understanding, you know, how it changes the cell, what signaling pathways it's using to replicate in order to persist, and also, you know, how HPV altering these signaling pathways can affect genomic stability of the cell, which could lead to cancer development.
So is there evidence that it causes instability of the genome?
Yeah, so if you take, so E7 is one of the HPV oncoproteins, and if you express it, or E6, which is the other oncoprotein in cells, they can both independently induce genomic instability, mm-hmm. DNA damage, and right. mutations.
And does that play a role in oncogenesis, the DNA damage?
Yeah, so by affecting the ability of the cell to repair DNA, mm-hmm. you know, any kind of DNA damage that occurs won't be repaired, and that can lead to, you know, genomic instability.
Right. So for people who are listening, can you explain how the oncoproteins of the virus cause transformation?
So I guess the most well-known ways that HPV can cause transformation is by affecting tumor suppressors. So mm-hmm. E6 is known to bind and target the tumor suppressor P53 for degradation. E7 can bind and target RB for degradation. And so what this does is it sets up the cell to continually be cycling. There's no checkpoints. Therefore, if you do have damage, there's no time really to repair it because the cell just keeps dividing, right. even though the damage is there. And in reality, E6 and E7 have multiple other targets that it affects, but as I said, most well-known are P53 and RB.
And as the cell keeps dividing, mutations accumulate, and eventually they become tumorigenic and metastatic.
Yeah, so E6 and E7 by themselves can't transform cells. You have to grow them for a really, really long time for them to transform. So other genetic changes have to take place, mm-hmm. but the tumors are reliant on E6 and E7 to keep them alive.
Right. So your work is obviously fundamental science, but you must think about immunization against HPVs mm-hmm. and how the uptake of vaccine in the U.S. isn't as good as it should be.
Yeah.
Can you send a message to our listeners about that?
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it's very frustrating, you know, that people are still thinking of this, you know, if my child is not sexually active, then I don't need to get the vaccine for them right now. But it's really important for them to get vaccinated when they're recommended to get vaccinated in order for them to, you know, generate an immune response to the virus in mm-hmm. case they are infected. And the reality is that 80% of sexually active individuals acquire a genital HPV infection. I mean, most people, the infection will clear, but in, you know, in a minority of people, they do establish a persistent infection, which is the major risk factor for cancer development.
Okay. Okay.
And just, you know, getting the vaccine, you're not only protecting yourself, but you're also protecting other people because you're not going to be passing the virus on to other people.
So what do you think you're going to be doing over the next 10 years?
Probably still trying to figure out how HPV is replicating in cells, and it's got two very distinctive phases of its life cycle. One that occurs in undifferentiated epithelial cells and one that occurs in differentiating epithelial cells, and just trying to figure out the differences between mm-hmm. the two, you know, how the virus manipulates the cell.
If a new high-risk HPV serotype were identified, would you do something with that?
Yeah, I think that, you know, as I mentioned, there are an increasing number of head and neck cancers that are associated with HPV, and you know, I think it would be interesting to determine how the virus acts in oral epithelial cells versus cervical epithelial
right.
cells.
Okay. Nat, you've been here exact same time, and so that was 6 years ago, roughly. What mm-hmm. what you were working on is probably the same as you're doing today, right? More or less.
For the most part.
For the most part. So, to tell us about that.
Yeah, a little bit of diversification along the way. The primary focus of what I'm interested in is protein synthesis, viral protein synthesis, mm-hmm. Sort of the RNA of a DNA virus. So human cytomegalovirus is the virus that we focus on the most. Here's my public health message version for the day. The original virus that causes birth defect and microcephaly, the virus that causes the most cases of congenital birth defect, Zika people. I'm very much interested in the sort of molecular virology, how viral mRNAs are transcribed, processed, and in particular translate during infection. And a little diversification since then into some RNA structure analysis of HCV transcripts and alpha viruses. Mark Heise's trying to slowly convert me into an RNA virologist unsuccessfully. So it's been a really neat 6 years to sort of mix and match the expertise on campus into and integrate it into what I do every day. So
do you see yourself continuing with HCMV?
I think HCMV will always be the major presence of what I do. I think more and more my interest begins to center on how viral mRNAs are translated into proteins. And in some cases, there's going to be interesting questions in other viruses. So
viruses, viral mRNAs have to be translated by the host machinery. So, and as we've learned, viruses can change it so that it benefits them, and it's, say, the whole translational machinery is directed towards. Is that something that you're interested in with HCMV?
Well, that's actually one of the reasons it's so interesting to study this in HCMV. So CMV doesn't have a shutoff function. So the problem is acute for HCMV mRNAs. There's not only do they have to avoid all the negative regulation to translation, they have to compete very efficiently with host mRNAs for access for ribosomes. So in HCMV, you kind of get to study both sides of that problem.
Yeah. Okay. And so you already answered the question of HCMV will keep you busy for the next foreseeable future,
I think,
right?
So.
All right. So Nancy, you can actually answer the question. When you first came, what did you work on, and how does it compare to what's going on now?
Well, I have worked on Epstein-Barr virus for 41 years, likely to jump onto something new.
Wow.
but it's been an interesting evolution, because when I started, we were the first lab that was allowed to clone a herpes virus at Chicago. First Bernard cloned herpes simplex, and then they finally allowed us to clone EBV. So we were doing such strange things as making restriction enzyme linkage maps and trying to identify what regions were transcribed. And at that time, we knew that EBV was in these unusual cancers that occurred in unusual spots of the world. So the question was, are there unusual strains? So we were trying to answer that at Chicago, trying to do that by hybridization kinetics, which you never want to learn. So we decided that the strains were the same, and then I came here and was interested, as I said, in these epithelial cell infections. And my thought was, since my thesis had shown that the strains, by a very crude method, were not different, perhaps the expression was different. And we found this region that was very abundantly transcribed in epithelial cells that was not transcribed in lymphocytes. And then that led us into this family of transcripts, which were then, Epstein-Barr virus was the first virus to be shown to encode microRNAs. And lo and behold, this family of transcripts that we had discovered is the template for 44 microRNAs. And the remaining highly spliced transcript functions as a long non-coding RNA. So when I came here, I was intent on identifying what proteins were made by the messages. Then I spent 25 years studying two proteins that we considered our oncogenes, and how they activated signaling pathways and transformed. And now I would say my lab is definitely leaning more to how these viral non-coding RNAs affect cell growth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So if I remember, you used to work on a restriction fragment called BARF.
BART, yes, the BARF. Well, it's an open reading frame called BARF.
BARF, right?
Yeah, BAMA, right word frame.
Yes. I remember that. At meetings, you would say, this is BARF.
Well, BARF, yes. BARFO actually was the first thing we started working on. And we spent a lot of time trying to determine whether these open reading frames that were in these transcripts made proteins. And finally decided, after tagging all of them and expressing them and searching for them in infected cells, that they don't make proteins. And then with the discovery of microRNAs, we began to determine how they function. But I've been saying recently that microRNAs have destroyed my belief in God, because I mean, they're really very much you can see how they would evolve for just a small tweaking function. They kind of go along with the right. cell and kind of manipulate it very slightly. So now we're discovering that that's basically what is expressed in the tumors that develop in people who are not immunocompromised. If you're immunocompromised, EBV goes into its whole transforming mode and can force cells to grow. Mm-hmm. But if you're not, those cancers are not expressing the oncoproteins, mm-hmm. and it's the non-coding RNAs that are, I'm sure, in concert with genetic changes leading to cancer.
Do you think there'll ever be a EBV vaccine?
Yes, I do. I mean, there was an astonishing paper that showed that just the one antibodies to the one major glycoprotein is protective in a rhesus model. Mm. This was by Jeff Cohen at NIH did this.
And that vaccine would be given early in life, obviously, right?
Well, that's difficult to say exactly when you should give it because I mean, it wouldn't be very good for Burkitt's lymphoma because those children are infected very early, probably from breastfeeding, yeah. Possibly from breastfeeding. But it would be very important for people, it would be very useful for the United States. It would keep people from having to drop out of college for a semester mm-hmm. because they got mono.
Right.
So economically, it would make sense. But then for these other diseases, if people don't know that actually 10% of all or 20% of all gastric cancers are also caused by EBV. Mm. And in this country, 40% of Hodgkin's lymphoma are caused by EBV. In Brazil, all Hodgkin's lymphoma contains EBV. So a vaccine that's stopped, if you could give them probably around the age of 5, I would guess, maybe, yeah. or 7, would probably, I think, eliminate these cancers.
Wow. So what's in the cards for the next 10 years for you?
Oh, I'm afraid I may have to learn bioinformatics. Actually, I think as I sail off into the sunset, I would like to make people more aware of the importance of viruses in the development of cancer. Mm-hmm. And I've just been appointed to an advisory board for the NCI, where it's astonishing how little viruses are appreciated amongst this board. And so I see my campaign for the next 6 years to make them appreciate that. Sure. We could really do a lot against cancer if we could control these viruses. Hmm. And now both Dirk and I have been working on things called exosomes, which are another way viruses can manipulate their environment and also probably contribute to cancers that they're not even in the malignant cells.
Okay, Lishan, how long have you been here again?
20 years.
20 years?
20 years,
okay,
yeah.
So when you came, what were you working on?
So I came really to try to study how HIV interacts with the human immune system mm-hmm. on the hypothesis that the virus will provide the best tool to understand human immunology. And it turned out to be a very correct way to do it. And we have learned a great deal about how human immune system function based on how HIV outmaneuvers the human immunity. And ironically, AIDS is a hyperimmune activation disease. So.
Right.
So we identified viral factors leading to that phenotype and also host responding effector molecule important for that disease. And I call this the axis of all evil for AIDS. Essentially, it's an interferon-producing pathway where HIV head-on just induced a lot of interferon and it evolved way to outmaneuver the interferon and the interferon at the same time, help the virus persist and cause all the disease. That's why the last 20 years we've done that. And,
do you have a model, an animal model that you use to study this?
We have a different model. We have a tissue culture model, mm-hmm. organ culture model, an animal model, transgenic model. So to follow your poliovirus model, actually, I spent about 10 years working with Dan Littman, where we replace all the mouse version of the genes and replace with human genes, all right. the missing, about 4 or 5 of the genes, and we test HIV infection. Does not replicate. Mm-hmm. So that's why I finished, yeah. So after we learned all the HIV, for the last 10 years, I also diversify a little bit, is to work on another retrovirus called hepatitis B virus. It's really, people don't link these two viruses together. It's very similar in many ways. It's a pararetrovirus. By definition, it's slightly mm-hmm. different. It keeps the genome stable in the cell as a cccDNA, very much like a papillomavirus. and treatment is very difficult. It's incurable for 95% of people, but 5% of them are curable. So I jump ahead of your question. So that's the next 10 years probably is where my group is going to focus on how to cure HBV infection or increase the 5% cure to a slightly high percentage. Mm. Mainly using the knowledge we learned from studying HIV. Interestingly, I think HIV provides a way to understand how immune system work, and using that knowledge, we hopefully a curable disease like hepatitis B will be achieved in the next 10 years.
So tell us what you're thinking. Like, how could you cure an HBV infected person?
So hepatitis B virus, I guess it's very curable because it's just by natural history, it's very curable. Only in adult patient after infection, mm-hmm. 95% the patient clear.
Right.
It's really the children, especially in China, about 100 million people infected, mostly from mother to child mm-hmm. transmission. And the tolerance induced is the one really make the cure very difficult. So immune tolerance is the one prevent a good antiviral immunity. Mm-hmm. So very opposite from HIV. HIV is head on fighting the immune system. Hepatitis B mostly escape from the immune detection. And somehow, when your immune system start to work, they have this ccDNA continuously express the viral protein, induce a stable immune tolerance. So to cure that, the antiviral, fortunately, the HIV antiviral and RT inhibitor work quite well for hepatitis B, mm-hmm. new viral replication. But the cccDNA is resistant to that. It keep producing a protein called S antigen. So the key for immune therapy for cure is to get rid of the S antigen and to induce anti-S antibody. Mm-hmm. That's a functional cure.
Okay.
To achieve that, really two things, target the ccDNA or remove the S antigen to induce anti-S antibody. So this is highly active research in both academic and in industry currently, mostly targeting the ccDNA use the RNA, you know, microRNA, antisense RNA. And
so the cccDNA is in liver cells, right?
It's in liver cells, right.
And these turn over. It's not like an HIV problem where you have a long-lived pool of cells that have integrated DNA and you can't get rid of them. With Hep B, you can, in theory, get...
So the difficulty for this virus is, so far, after 30 years studying virus, this is probably the most difficult or strangest virus to work with. There's no good system to study.
Right.
Nobody knows the stability of the cccDNA. People claim it lived for years because 10 years after antiviral treatment in patient,
right.
As soon as you stop antiviral, HBV comes back mm. rapidly. They assume it's the stability of the ccDNA. Yeah. So it can be 10 years. But so no, it's not clear, but I think ccDNA is stable.
Okay, so this is gonna keep you busy for the next 10 years,
right? 10 years before I retire.
All right, Jennifer, tell us how your program has evolved over the years.
So when I started, in our population, we were still seeing a lot of gamma herpes virus associated oral disease. Mm. A lot of hairy leukoplakia and a lot of KS. And so that's what we were studying in my laboratory, oral pathogenesis. And then the medications for HIV changed and protease inhibitors became more widely used. And with that, we saw a shift in the oral disease in our population. First, we saw a boom in terms of the numbers of warts we were seeing that were associated with HPV. And we also saw an increase in a salivary gland disease, which we didn't know what was causing it. And we, not just us, the field was doing a terrible job treating those people. A percentage of them would go from this disease onto lymphoma. Mm-hmm. So of course, I thought we might discover HHV9, but we did not. It turned out that that was a polyomavirus. And so it was BK polyomavirus that's mm-hmm. associated with kidney transplant, right. A failure. So it turns out that virus replicates very well in salivary gland disease and may be critical to polyoma transmission orally. So we've been studying oral HPV infection and BKV infection and looking at why these types of, why viruses in general are so successful in the oral cavity, and have learned more recently that the bacterial infections that are present in the mouth seem to facilitate viral reactivation and replication, and can even show both in vitro and in our clinical studies that if you diminish the bacterial infection, you decrease viral reactivation and replication.
You don't know why though, right?
Well, actually we do. Different bacteria do it differently, but the gram-negative anaerobes seem to activate different signal transduction pathways that allow for epigenetic changes at viral promoters, and you get reactivation. So the changes are not consistently the same. It depends on what the virus is and what the bacteria is, but certainly gram-positives do not do it very well. And there may be a combination of different products, so it's not just the LPS or the short-chain fatty acids or a number of others. It's a more complex group of factors that seem to be important for the activation of these pathways.
So you must look at the microbiome, right, by 16S RNA sequencing, I presume?
Yes, so we have looked at the microbiome. So those have been more independent interactions where we're treating virus-infected cells, but we do see when we provide comprehensive care to people, a nice shift in their microbiome, where we see decreases in the gram-negatives and then decreases in EBV, CMV, and other herpes viral infections.
Have you looked at the virome?
I actually talked to Dirk about that.
Yeah.
So we haven't done that yet.
Do you know David Pride at UCSD? You know his work?
Not personally.
So
but
we had him on TWiV a few months ago, and he studies the virome of the oral cavity and its relationship to health and oral disease and so forth. So it's really interesting and sounds very familiar. We also had on the same show Forrest Rower, who studies the virome of coral. And then both the oral virome and coral, it's all about mucus. So our mouth is basically a coral reef.
It's true. Actually, the first project that I did when I was a dental student was on mucins at University of Rochester.
There you go.
Yeah,
the mucus holds the bacteria and the viruses in this holobiont. You know, they call it a holobiont in coral, but our mouth is a holobiont. In fact, the whole earth is a holobiont. It's covered with mucus.
This episode is brought to you by Drobo. Drobos are storage units for your computer, and they're designed to solve two problems that affect hard disk drives. Hard drives get full, and hard drives are mechanical, and they will ultimately fail. Here's how Drobo solves these two problems. Drobos are storage units with multiple slots where you can put in individual hard drives. They're expandable. You could start with two or three drives and insert more later, and they use a Beyond Rage type of storage where all the drives are meshed together into a single pool of storage space. And you can use drives of different sizes in these Drobo arrays, and that's where you will store your information for your computer. You can mix and match of different sizes, and traditional RAID doesn't allow you to do this. So that removes the limitations of traditional RAID. Now, Drobos protect your data. They're data aware. They know how much of the capacity you're using. If you have a couple of drives in your Drobo and there are some lights on the side of the drives, they're green in normal operation. When it turns to yellow, this means that there's about 15% space left. And when there's a red light, you can't add any more files. And what do? You simply add another drive and it gets incorporated into the array. Or you could add a drive of bigger capacity. Drobos are redundant. It protects your data from a single or two hard drive failures. If a hard drive fails, you simply take it out, put in a new one, and all your data are restored because they're replicated across all of the drives on your Drobo. All of this is simple. Drobo uses colored lights to communicate the system status. If you understand a traffic light, you can use the Drobo. I have a bunch of Drobos here in my office and at home, and they are great. Now, which one is right for you? They make eight different products and depends what you want to use it for. For example, if you're a photographer and you generate a lot of large image files, you might want a Drobo 5D or 5DT. These will connect to your computer by Thunderbolt 2 or USB 3. They can take up to 5 hard drives, and you can store a lot of information on them. If you need a portable solution, if you go out in the field, they have lightweight mini Drobos. They're about 2.2 pounds. Again, they connect up to your computer with a high-speed interface, but you can carry them with you and store files. If you're shooting on location, for example, you can store files out in the field. They even have an optional carrying case that would make this really a road warrior companion. If you need a ton of storage, a big bucket, or to store all of your files, they have 4 or 5 drive units. They also have 8 drive or 12 drive units as well. That's a ton of storage. You could put 12 4-terabyte drives. I don't know what the biggest capacity is right now. That's a ton of storage. The cool part is they also make Drobos that you can plug into your switch or router and make a network-attached storage device. That's the Drobo 5N, and you can share the data throughout your home and throughout your lab, which is what I do with our Drobo 5N. TWiX listeners can save $100 off of their purchase of a Drobo Mini, Drobo 5D, Drobo 5N, or any 8-drive or 12-drive system. Just go to drobostore.com. and use the discount code MICROBE100. We thank Drobo for their support of TWiV.
Blossom, what is the timing here? When should I stop?
Yeah, so you have about 20 minutes before the next batch.
Okay, so we're starting the next one at 3.
Yes.
Or so I should finish a few minutes before. Yes. Okay, thank you. Good. I have a few more questions for you. And maybe these are even more fun. So, Dirk, what's the single coolest experiment your lab has ever done? It could be really simple.
It's probably the one we do tomorrow, right? How's that for an answer?
No. It's not a bad answer, but kind of dodging the question.
So, we actually... So 10% of my lab is treasure hunting for new viruses.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not systematic, and it probably is not as rational as one would like it to be. But that's when my friend calls me from the ER and he says, I have this person, X number of year old person, no history of anything. He comes in, he's in the ER, and he dies 3 days later. And we have no idea why, and can you help us? And that's when we have a very nice pipeline to simply sequence either a lung sputum or whatever it is and see if we can find something. And lo and behold, we do find things and we can help them. Well, we can't help them. We do find things, why it is. And sometimes we find viruses. And that's important because if you know what the virus is, you know which antiviral to give. If you don't know what the virus is, you don't. And that's came out. Those things are very exciting, to be honest.
Okay, so discovery is exciting to you.
Absolutely.
All right. Carrie, what's the most exciting experiment your lab has done?
Oh, man. One of the most interesting ones from the result standpoint, I would say, is that we're looking at how the DNA damage response can modify HPV chromatin. It's associated with histones. And one of the postdocs in the lab has found that there's a central region in the HPV genome that's enriched for this certain histone modification that has been shown to be important in driving repair on cellular DNA through homologous recombination. And so it suggests that HPV may be using the DNA damage response to modify viral chromatin in order to recruit DNA repair factors, which are important for driving viral replication.
Okay, and that's exciting because it leads to a whole new area of investigation to figure out what's going on, right?
Yes.
Okay. Nat, how about you?
So this, I'm not going to answer the question. This is a setup. If I answer this, no matter what I say, everybody but one person in my lab is going to be mad at me. So instead, I think... the favorite technique that we run in the lab right now.
That's fine.
We separate polysomes every day. Mm-hmm. Old school polysome fractionation over
impressed.
Gradient.
Yeah.
And I think that is the most fascinating thing to watch.
Yeah.
I don't know why. Every time the fractionator runs,
I used to do that as a technician. It was so much fun.
If I know they're separating polysomes, I'll come out of my office and stand there and watch the trace come off on the absorbance reader.
Yeah.
So not a particularly flashy or new technique, but
so that was a technique we used ages ago. It went away, but now that you can probe the gradient, you know, for total genomes, total RNAs, it becomes more powerful again, right? And
that's exactly what we're doing with it. It is really cool to, you know, the technique when I first set it up in the lab was from, you know, papers from 1968 to 1973, exclusively. So we
used to do northern blots and look for one RNA, right? And across the gradient, we thought that was pretty cool. But being able to look at the total RNA, that makes it neat. Yeah, I like techniques too. Our favorite is the plaque assay. Right. Best. Nancy, what is your coolest result?
Well, I think my coolest result was the experiment I did first when I came here, or maybe it was not first, shortly thereafter, was showing that EBV had different patterns of expression in different cell types, and that led to the description of at least three types of latency. So that has clarified our understanding of EBV.
Okay. I could ask you a really hard question. What's the most exciting experiment that you will do? But we can't answer that, so I won't ask.
It would depend on money.
That's right. Lishan, what about you?
Well, it's hard beside our animal model we are doing. I think the really fun experiment, most interesting to me, was done by a former graduate student. He designed something called a degrecan. Essentially, we figured out HIV VPU can trap protein in the ER, degrading whatever protein bind to. So he was very clever. He said, we can study cytokine receptor this way by fuse the cytokine to a VPU. Then put in cell, you'll trap the receptor in the ER, the VPU will degrade the receptor. It's essentially the genetic way to study every cytokine receptor function.
Right.
It was beautifully designed and beautifully worked. It's so much fun doing the experiment.
Great.
Yeah. The bad news is, I think 3 months after this publication in Nature Biotech, the siRNA was invented. So people do everything with siRNA. They don't need this degrecan for study receptor anymore.
Right. Jennifer, how about you?
I think it is the BK experiment. Because there we made a clinical observation, described the virus that was there, built an in vitro system, characterized what was happening in terms of pathogenesis, figured out a drug that would work, and now we're finishing a clinical trial. So I think that really, to be able to translate and see that loop was most exciting to me.
Sounds good. I asked the same question, by the way. I interviewed a number of other scientists for the textbook, and you can find their answers there, people like Mike Bishop, Phil Sharp, David Baltimore. It's interesting to see how they answer. I find it, I phrase it slightly differently, but it's the same idea. I'm going to ask you all one more question, and then we'll stop. If you had not been a scientist, what would you be doing now? Did I ask you, Blossom, that? I think so. No? Ask him. Like early in your life, what did you want to do that you might have ended up doing?
Well, wow. My son wants to be a pirate, and maybe that's pretty good, actually.
A pirate?
Yes.
You want to be a pirate?
Yeah. Well, my son, yeah, because you get to hunt for treasure, and I'm still doing that. Only was
you need to move closer to the coast.
So, what kind of a pirate would you be? Now, you would be on a ship and
an explorer of some sort, and I take pictures. I do still pictures.
Okay,
actually.
But you wouldn't actually make any money, but you'd like to do that, right? Which is fine. It wasn't.
I don't make money as a scientist either.
Okay, very good. Carrie, what would you be if not a scientist?
I don't know. Early on, I thought I wanted to be a doctor, but then I realized I didn't really like to be around people that much. So I thought it would be better to be a scientist in the lab, but then in actuality, you have a lot of interactions with people. But I don't know, I kind of always wanted to own a bookstore.
A bookstore.
Yeah, something simple.
I've had that answer before.
Yeah.
That's interesting. And there are still bookstores. So you could have a small one, right?
Yeah.
Okay, that's cool. Nat, you can't get out of this one. You're not going to offend anybody.
The only the only thing I can ever recall, other than, of course, professional athlete, which was never going to happen, I remember when I was a kid, I really wanted to be a mechanic. I just absolutely wanted to be an auto mechanic.
Mm-hmm.
And when I grew out of that, I wanted to become a scientist. And so if I wasn't doing this, it would probably be manual labor, heavy lifting somewhere. I don't have a lot of other, you know, marketable skill sets, I don't think, at this point.
All right, Nancy?
Well, I wanted to be an archaeologist, which is, I think, science still.
Yeah, it is.
And I almost was going to major in that till I took a course and decided I didn't really want to spend my life dusting off bones. But I was offered two jobs. One was working in the Museum of Natural Sciences, numbering bones and sorting bones in the summertime, or working for this virologist when I learned how to do tissue culture and grow viruses. And that was the split.
Mm-hmm.
But when I retire, perhaps I'd go brush bones for some famous archaeologist somewhere.
Lishan.
Yeah, it's interesting. I think if I didn't follow my high school physics teacher's advice, I would have been a historian or a writer. That's probably what I don't
know. A historical writer, is that what you said?
Either historian or writer or historic writer.
Okay. Do you do any of that?
I read and follow. I'm married a historian.
Yeah, okay. Jennifer?
I could be a full-time dentist, but the other thing I would have been is a musician.
Ah. What would you play?
So I played a lot of instruments growing up. I played viola, violin, piano, I sang. And then, but you never got to do anything fun with those, but the marching band, you got to do stuff. So
yeah.
I went to the band leader and said, what do you need? And then I learned how to play the tuba.
Nice.
So.
Tuba, wow.
Yeah.
Is that fun to play?
It is, and it's really easy.
Huh.
You don't have to carry it around.
There are three keys, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then you have to control your mouth.
Yeah, but your embouchure is loose, not like a trumpet, so it's not...
And the cheeks puff out, right, when you play?
They can, if you don't control it. The problem is the wind in the marching band, right?
Right.
Because the wind gets in there and you fall
so these,
over.
These are the big guns that
curl up. Yeah, the sousaphone.
With a big opening, right? Nice, that's a great
concert
answer.
Concert band, you have the one sitting there.
All right, before we wrap up, is there anything any of you want to say to our listeners? We have tens of thousands of listeners who, you know, they're waiting for your comments. Is there anything you want to say about you or the program or North Carolina, Chapel Hill? Anything whatsoever? Last chance.
Well,
go ahead.
What you've seen is that at UNC, we now have every virus growing that one can think of, and that's really unique. There isn't any virus, save for Ebola, but that's actually coming in 3 weeks as a dead virus because we have someone who's working on clinical trials in Sierra Leone. But yeah, having every virus at your disposal is tremendous fun.
Anyone else?
Oh, I would like to say if there's any budding molecular biologists out there or cell biologists that if they really want to understand the cell, they should study a virus that infects that cell because that virus is just going to take apart every molecular system inside the cell. And I think it's the best way to really get at the biochemistry and molecular biology of eukaryotes or prokaryotes.
All right, that's part one of TWiV 407. You can find it at iTunes. You can find it at microbe.tv/TWiV. If you have an iPhone or an Android device, there are many programs that you can use that are free that you can use to play the episodes. If you, even if you don't use iTunes, by the way, please go there and find our show and give it a star rating. You can do 1 to 5 stars. And of course, you want to give it 5 stars because it's a 5-star show, right? And that keeps us high in the listings over there at iTunes. And more people will discover us that way. We want more people to listen and learn about virology, which is just an amazing subject. You can also support us financially if you'd like. Right now we're running ads, but we also have listener support. which we would like to do more of. You can go to microbe.tv/contribute, and we have a Patreon account, which you'll find there, where you can give $1 a month to us, or you can give us money in chunks with your credit card or by PayPal as well. I'd like to thank everyone today for participating in part one. Dirk Dittmer, thank you very much.
Thank you. It was nice to be here.
Carrie Moody, thank you.
Thank you.
Nat Moorman, thank you very much.
Thanks.
Nancy Rob Traub, thank you so much.
Can I do this on a flip phone? Can I watch it?
No, I don't think so. You still have a flip phone? Yeah, I saw someone on the airplane. I saw someone on the airplane yesterday with a flip phone. I'm like,
what's wrong with this person?
No, you can't do anything except call, right?
Oh. And only if you have it with you.
Can you text message even?
Well, I can, but it takes quite a while.
All right, so you can do that. Now, you need a smartphone, they call it. So you should get one. You never wanted one?
I've heard that.
You never wanted it. Okay, you should get one. You work on her, okay? Lishan Su, thank you so much.
Great to be here.
And Jennifer Webster Syriac, thank you.
Thank you
for joining us. I'm Vincent Racaniello. You can find me at virology.ws. The sponsors of this show, CuriosityStream and Drobo, I would like to thank for their support of TWiV. You've been listening to This Week in Virology. Thanks for joining us. We'll be back next week. Another TWiV is viral.